Good evening, everyone, and thanks for being with us tonight. First of all, I'd like to apologize for the delay. I hope we'll be able to make up for that with all the snacks that we're offering afterwards. And needless to say, with a great talk by tonight's speaker, I'm very pleased to be able to introduce Professor Stephen Wise. Steve Wise is an adjunct professor at several law schools and universities in the United States, as well as the founder and leader of the Nonhuman Rights Project, which means that he's a pioneer in the field of trying to achieve actual legal personhood and rights for the first non-human animal in history. And so, yeah, without further ado, he'll be presenting on his Nonhuman Rights Project, and I'm looking forward to it. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you very much for having me here. I do warn you, I have not slept in 30 hours, so if I start to wander, just throw something at me and I'll know what it meant, what it means. Also, if people are interested, after you hear my talk, if you're interested in getting the newsletter from the e-newsletter from the Nonhuman Rights Project, if you just put your name and your email address, whatever, that would be great and you'll get it. So I'll just pass these around. And you can look at them. So, the Nonhuman Rights Project has a history that, and it has goals. And I want to take you back a while. I'm going to take you back to where my hair color was the same as yours, and that would be in the early 1980s. So at that time, I was a young lawyer, and in Boston, and I read Peter Singer's book, and reading that book, philosophers can make a difference. So once I read that book, I decided that I had been a lawyer. I wanted to become a lawyer because I was interested in issues of social justice, and I realized from reading that, and I didn't really know, I hadn't really thought about how we treated non-human animals, and I realized that we treated them horribly. Of course, I'd been treating them horribly my whole life. Not my companion animals, who I love, but the ones that I was eating and wearing and probably going to circuses or zoos or whatever I did. And I decided that the way that I could have the largest social justice impact would be to try to help non-human animals. So about that time, I also met, well, for about a year, I thought I was the only animal protection lawyer in the world. I didn't know of anyone else. And there was essentially no animal rights movement. Now we're talking 1980. So I've been doing this now for 34 years. And things are looking up. In 1980, they were not looking up. There were only a few of us. I knew probably personally within the first year all the animal rights activists in the United States. And now I only know 20% perhaps of the lawyers who are teaching animal law, animal rights law in American law schools. So it's just exploded way beyond anything that I ever could have imagined. I then met up with some other lawyers who were interested, and we formed an organization called the Animal Legal Defense Fund out of San Francisco. And I became the president of that from 1985 until 1995. And that's where we really began to think about and sit around and talk. Like, okay, we see the problem. Non-human animals are treated terribly. You know, what are we going to do about it? And there was really, there weren't really any guidelines, or there was no clear way. So we started to litigate both in our personal law practices as well as through the Animal Legal Defense Fund. And about 1985 or so, I realized that this was not going to work. It's not going to work on a long-term basis, and it wasn't going to change in the fundamental way that needed to be changed the lives of non-human animals. And at that time, I set up a 30-year plan, and I'm happy to say that I might succeed in 30 years, but in year 28, that's when I've actually filed the first lawsuits. I actually set out a 30-year plan that I hoped would lead to the first lawsuits being filed in an attempt to make non-human animals legal persons, which I talk about. But I thought it was going to take about 30 years because there were virtually no classes that were being taught about it. There was no academic respectability. There were no books. There were no articles. And in fact, I learned about it by reading philosophers' books for 10, 15 years until I finally decided in the early 1990s that I would start writing books that would talk about animal rights in a legal sense. Because in 1985, I thought, when I'm making this 30-year plan, we have to gain academic respectability. We have to start writing books. We have to start writing law review articles. We had to also wait for the society to reach a point where the members of society cared about what we were saying. And when my first book came out, Rattling the Cage, Toward Legal Rights for Animals in 2000, I'm on film speaking to people, and they're asking me, well, when do you think the first suits are going to be filed? And I said, oh, I don't know, I'd say about 10 years. So it turned out it was 13 years. But there was a plan in which we had to begin to figure out how we could really stop talking philosophy and start talking law. One thing that happened was Peter Singer was not only the person who got me involved in the animal rights movement, but he was, that was in a positive way, but he was a person who actually got me moving in the direction that I'm moving in, as well as my friend and colleague David Faber, who's been a law professor in the U.S. for 35 years as well. We were invited by Peter Singer and Paola Cavallari to submit a chapter in their book, The Great Ape Project, which came out simultaneously with the formation of the group, The Great Ape Project, which I think was about 1992. And so David and I had been thinking about what it is we needed to do, because we had decided several years before that the issue that we had to grapple with was the issue of legal personhood. And legal personhood, we define, or I define, as meaning having the capacity for a legal right, for one or more legal rights. Sometimes I talk about it in terms of legal personhood being a rights container. Hold on, it has to be empty. Now we have a legal person here who is a rights container. You don't have to have any rights in there, but you have to be recognized by the society, through the legislature, or through the courts, as having the capacity to have rights. And then we can have this kind of picture of rights that we would then go in front of courts or go before legislatures and say, this being is a rights container, and we begin to drip rights in, saying, well, how about the right to bodily liberty? How about the right to bodily integrity? How about the right not to be tortured, not to be imprisoned? And the problem then, and the problem remains, is how do we persuade legislatures, probably more in the civil law system, but I'll tell you a little bit about the common law system, because that's what David and I, and then ultimately I and the Nonhuman Rights Project decided to pursue, the idea of rights in a common law system. How could we persuade common law courts to declare that a non-human animal, any non-human animal, was a rights container, so we could begin arguing with them about what rights, what legal rights, our non-human animal plaintiff should have. So it was that problem that David and I began working on in the mid to late 1980s, and by the early 1990s, we had come up with some kind of a primitive argument, which I'm embarrassed when I read it today, how terrible and primitive it was, and you would be embarrassed. You could be embarrassed for me when you open up the book, The Great Ape Project, and you can see it, except for the fact it's not there. And it not being there turned out to be a real important turning point for me, because Peter Singer, at the last moment, kicked our article out of the book, because we were not writing about philosophy. My friend Joyce Tischler, who is a longtime head of the Animal Legal Defense Fund, wrote a law review article a year or two ago, in which she was talking about the history of the Animal Legal Defense Fund, and she got hold of the email correspondence between David Faber and I and Peter Singer about why you're kicking our article out, and Peter saying you have to make this kind of change, and we're saying, lawyers don't talk like that. We're not making that kind of change. And he says, you're not going in the book. And we say, okay, we're not going in the book. And we don't go in the book. And that, for me, was an epiphany. Because up until then, I thought, you know, lawyers and philosophers, when they're talking about terms like rights and personhood, they're talking about the same thing. And from that day in 1992 until today, I realized that we're not talking about the same thing. So I haven't read any philosophy since. But I do read a lot of jurisprudence. And I spent years and years and years after doing one thing. After we got kicked out, I was a little bit upset about it. And so I went on a legal research, computer legal research tool. I used it. And I put in the word Peter Singer. And while I also added the word Tom Reagan, another prominent animal rights philosopher in the US. And I ran their names through every single appellate decision that had ever been decided by an American court since 1619. And there were none. None ever used the word Peter Singer or Tom Reagan. And that made me realize judges are not philosophers. At least they're not in the United States. Judges don't understand philosophy. They're not trained in philosophy. And they don't care about it. And if you want to make their eyes glaze over, you can start talking about philosophy. But you're not going to win cases by talking to an American judge about philosophy. When I put the word Aristotle in, only a few hits came out. I mean, they don't really talk about philosophy. They are two different worlds. I had not really understood that. And so David and I immediately, and I certainly have kept going, really kind of never looked back at philosophy and began to focus on jurisprudence. Now, sometimes jurisprudence and philosophy connect, two Venn diagrams. You could have jurisprudence and philosophy, and at some points they may connect, but they certainly are not the same thing. And oftentimes they're not even close to being the same thing. So I began to then work on jurisprudence and try to understand such fundamental issues as, if I'm seeking legal personhood and legal rights for non-human animal, well, how did humans get them? So I actually spent 7 years studying where rights came from, where personhood came from, before I began to write about it. And then I began to write a series of law review articles. And for those of you who aren't lawyers, or you who are lawyers who don't read law review articles, that's in the United States, each law school has five or six or seven student publications in which lawyers and law professors usually publish their legal research. So there's hundreds of them in the United States. And so I began to write articles that I wanted to get published. And then I did. I wrote a bunch of them. And then somewhere around 1996, I realized that nobody was reading them. And that wasn't the reason I'd spent all that time, so I began to look around for someone who might publish a trade book. And I found a publisher. I found a wonderful editor in Boston who's been my editor now for 15 years, extraordinarily supportive of me. And I then began to publish research and publish a series of books in which I tried not to talk like a lawyer. In fact, some of my favorite reviews were, "This is a wonderful book. It doesn't look like it was written by a lawyer." And I thought, well, I think that's a compliment. So people, I would hope, would understand what I was saying. And also, lawyers would have a chance of understanding it, as would judges. I was hoping that I'd be able to write in a way that would be entertaining, that might be funny, but that would make really making the serious point of why non-human animals are entitled to personhood and fundamental legal rights. And the two fundamental legal rights I had begun to write about were bodily liberty, bodily integrity. The idea that you can't imprison a non-human animal, can't put her in a cage, and bodily integrity. You can't, what in law would be, you can't commit a battery on a non-human animal, an unconsented to touching. So you can't eat them, you can't vivisect them, you can't touch them. The way that if someone touches me intentionally to try to harm me in some way, at least in the common law system, I can sue them for a battery. And if they try to touch me and they don't succeed, I may be able to sue them for assault. So, or assault and battery. So, th- those articles or that book then accomplished what I was hoping. Rattling the Cage was then reviewed widely within the legal literature, which made me very happy, by very prominent people. And it was reviewed in the Harvard Law Review, in the Yale Law Journal, by a sitting federal judge who is very prominent, by very well-known law professors. And in fact, the whole series of law professors kind of came out of the animal rights closet. Hey, how did I know that they were in favor of animal rights? Nobody had ever said anything about it. So I was very pleased about that. And there were lots and lots of comments about it. And that caused me, as I was on speaking tours, people would, because I'd focused on chimpanzees and bonobos, also sometimes known as pygmy chimpanzees, and why they were entitled to personhood, and why they were entitled to the rights, to fundamental rights to bodily liberty and bodily integrity, people would ask me, well, where do you draw the line? And so I named my next book, Drawing the Line, Science and the Case for Animal Rights, where I set out lines that could be drawn, although in a way that people oftentimes don't understand what I meant. What I did is begin to develop an idea, partly from Kant, and Kant is a real two-edged sword. So the idea that a being who is autonomous, and I write about what autonomy means, and why autonomy is a sufficient, not a necessary. But see, I still do think about philosophy sometimes. But why autonomy is a sufficient condition for legal personhood and certain fundamental rights, but it's not a necessary condition. So many people misunderstand that. I read about my theories all the time, and except they're not my theories. They misunderstand them, and they think that I'm saying that autonomy is a necessary condition for rights. So this guy is just looking at the relatively handful of non-human animals, and then what happens? The answer is, well, I don't know what happens, but what I tell people is that if I can't get personhood and legal rights for autonomous beings like chimpanzees, then I can't get them for, I'm not going to get them for pigs or chickens, or, and I wouldn't even try. So both I and then later the Nonhuman Rights Project, you know, focuses on autonomous beings. And we know that once we begin bringing lawsuits in front of common law courts, asking them to find that our autonomous plaintiffs are legal persons with these certain fundamental rights, we understand that we can't predict what's going to happen. It may stop with them. It may go, we don't know how deep into the animal kingdom it would go, but certainly once we win a lawsuit, it's going to be a big deal, and legislatures are going to hop in. And the United States, each of the 50 states is a separate sovereign. So there are 50 legislatures. There are 50 state Supreme Courts. It's a very complex issue. So the Nonhuman Rights Project then really kicked into gear in about 2007. And I began, I teach at so many law schools, I think I was teaching at 5 law schools then. And I would go to my top students and say, would you like to volunteer and help me? And I got some really smart, committed people to work with me. And then other people began to find out, and we began to branch out or enlarge, till at one point I think we had 70 volunteers and I don't know how many we have now, because they kind of go in and out, and the problems that we have sometimes require a lot of people to work with us and sometimes don't. But we set up a whole series of working groups. We set up a legal working group. Probably half or so of our volunteers have been lawyers or law students or law professors. But we also have had a science working group that was led by a neuroscience scientist. We've had a sociology working group that was led by sociologists, because we began the process of trying to figure out what judges might kind of intuitively be sympathetic to us, what judges might intuitively be hostile to us, what judges might not care about us at all. Which we may like those judges. We might like the fact that we're going in front of a judge who hasn't really thought about this before. But we especially want to know which ones are going to hate us from the good morning. So our sociologists began working on that, looking at all the sociological literature that had been published in English by academics, talking about what sort of judge, you know, how judges who might be of a certain gender, a certain religion, they went to a certain law school, they're a certain age, how they might tend to rule. So we looked at them, and then we went deeper. We also had we have a predictive analytics working group, which has been a very difficult thing. We essentially put together all of the decisions of a sitting state Supreme Court, and we say, here you are, here's the 3,000 decisions of this court over the last 6 years. Tell us whether these, you know, any of these judges are going to be sympathetic to us. And you have to come up with some kind of algorithms, you have to develop them, so that will lead to something that we can possibly use. And it turns out, and so we have mathematicians who are involved in that, and statisticians are involved in that. It's been an extraordinarily difficult problem, and sometimes I think it's really the kind of a problem that, you know, a $2 billion corporation hires, you know, have a department for $50 million and figures something like that out. But we work with them. We have social media folks who work with us, and so there's a lot of people all moving towards the first suits that we were planning. So from 2007, we put in about 30,000 hours of work to get ready for the first suits that we were going to file, because we had to run from a legal point of view. We looked at about 60 different legal issues, and we ran them through all 50 states. So that meant there were approximately 3,000 separate issues that we had to evaluate. And then we actually tried to rank all of the states, all 50 states, as to how favorable they might be. And of course, there's none that are completely favorable or completely unfavorable, so we had to make all kinds of judgment calls. And we would, our legal working group would oftentimes shut ourselves up in a hotel room in Manhattan for a weekend and just argue about it. But by the end of 2012, we had come up with what we thought were about the top 5 to 10 states. And then on Easter weekend of 2013, we emerged from our hotel room in Manhattan with the number one state, which was the state of New York, which happened to be where we were arguing. Because we knew New York was one of those top states, we had our science working group come up with a list of all, actually for the top 10 states, I believe. We wanted to know where all of the apes were in these 10 states. Do they have apes? Do they have cetaceans, whales and dolphins? Do they have elephants, African elephants, Asian elephants? Because the work that I had been doing over the years had oftentimes involved looking at those kinds of non-human animals, because they are, number one, they have been studied so intensively, both in the wild and in captivity. Number two, what scientists had learned about them was that they were extraordinarily cognitively complex beings. And the more you look at them, it's extraordinary. And my books, Drawing the Line, Rattling the Cage, you know, I spend a chapter on each of these sorts of animals talking about what's known 14 years ago and 13 and 10, 11 years ago. And then something else, the kind of intelligence that they had was the kind of intelligence, or at least it intersects broadly, with the kind of intelligence that we have. So we thought that judges will be more likely to empathize and understand a kind of intelligence that's similar to the kind of intelligence that they have. So that's why we essentially chose from a pool of four species of apes, two species of elephants, and I don't know how many species of cetaceans. We're looking at orcas, we're looking at dolphins, some kinds of dolphins, beluga whales possibly. And then in New York, it turned out there weren't any cetaceans in captivity, so that was the end of that. There were lots of elephants, chimpanzees, gorillas, and there may have been an orangutan or two. And we then looked at the whole series of candidates, and we decided that we were going to chose two chimpanzees who were being kept in a roadside zoo in upstate New York, or central New York. And their names were Reba and Merlin. And we learned about them, and then I went to visit them a month later, because we began then putting our first case together, And let me actually put Reba and Merlin right here. I'll come back to that. Don't forget, if I forget, I have to bring Reba and Merlin back. The kind of suit that we were going to file was going to be a common law writ of habeas corpus. Now, the habeas corpus is something that was begun, created by the common law courts. And let me give you a 30-second discussion about common law. It's not what you have here. It's probably as strange to you as civil law is to me. That common law, in the United States or in English-speaking countries, judges can wield an extraordinary amount of power. They can actually make the law. So legislatures, after a couple hundred year fight between the legislatures and the judges in England, it turned out that the legislature, the parliament, was dominant. So today, in English-speaking countries, the legislative branch will dominate the judicial branch as to what the law is. But in the common law countries, there's not that much legislative law. There's not that many statutes compared to civil law countries. And common law judges make a huge amount of law as a byproduct of them deciding individual cases. And one of the kinds of law they made was the writ of habeas corpus. And that had caught my attention. I think I spent about a page on it in Rattling the Cage. And a specific case had caught my attention. In 1772, the Court of King's Bench in London had a case. A man named James Somerset had escaped. He was an escaped slave. And he was found. He was put on a ship, the Anna Mary, and he was going to be sailed to Jamaica, where he would be sold in the slave markets, and he would then have to harvest sugar in Jamaica until he died, which would probably be 3 to 5 years later. And we don't know for sure. It was probably his godparents, because that's why slaves were baptized in England in the 18th century, to get godparents who would help them escape, essentially. So we don't actually still have the original writ of habeas corpus, but there's so much written about it that it appears it was probably his godparents brought a case before the Court of King's Bench, which was dominated by probably the greatest judge ever to speak English, Lord Mansfield, who was the Chief Justice of the Court of King's Bench in 1772. And they said that he should be freed. The writ of habeas corpus is Latin, essentially, almost, well, it actually is entirely Latin, but it means approximately produce the body. So a writ of habeas corpus, a common law writ of habeas corpus, anyone can file, usually on behalf of just about anybody. And this occurs when someone else is being imprisoned. If you happen to be in prison and they'll let you out to file a writ of habeas corpus, then you can do that too. But that's not very often how they're brought, because usually people imprisoning other people don't let them out to file writs of habeas corpus. So somebody else would tend to file a writ of habeas corpus. And the judge would then issue a writ of habeas corpus, and the respondent, the person who's the jailer, has to bring in the body of the person that he or she is imprisoning and give a legally sufficient reason for imprisoning that body. Now, writs of habeas corpus apply only to legal persons. And not persons, humans, but legal persons. In fact, in 1771, it had never been applied to a black person in England. It had been applied only to white people, and usually white Englishmen, English women. So Lord Mansfield did not have to issue the writ of habeas corpus. He did, because he could have done what in the United States many of the Southern courts did before our American Civil War in 1861. He just says, this black man in front of me is a thing and not a person. Habeas corpus is not used for things. You lose. And Lord Mansfield didn't do it, and there's a backstory to that, because this was about the fourth or fifth case that had been brought before him, engineered by Granville Sharp, who was known as the first abolitionist. And really the purpose of my book was to talk about how Sharp did it and why Lord Mansfield ended up granting the writ of habeas corpus. Because Granville Sharp had decided 5 years before that he was kind of like me when I read about Peter Singer, for various reasons, mostly him being sued, he really, when he helped free a slave, he realized he hadn't really thought about slavery. It was just all around him, just like I hadn't thought about non-human animals, even though they were all around me, how non-human animals were being enslaved. And so he, this is about the fifth or sixth case in which Granville Sharp had some hand in bringing a case in front of Lord Mansfield. He had decided that slavery was going to end in England and Lord Mansfield was going to end it. He just had not told Lord Mansfield. So he kept bringing these series of cases. And this was the most important. Everyone realized for all kinds of reasons it was the most important case. And it had hearing after hearing after hearing, which is unusual for England in the 18th century. In England, in a felony jury trial in England, the average case, including jury deliberations, lasted about 12 minutes. And so the idea that you would have a case that went on for 7 months was extraordinary. And at one point, Lord Mansfield wanted it. He didn't want any part of it. He tried to get the parties to settle, and they wouldn't do it. Both of them saw that this was the test case that they'd been looking for. Because when the captain of the Anne and Mary brings James Somerset into court, what's the legally sufficient reason he's going to give? Well, heck, it's like he's like my horse. He's like my chair. He's a thing. That's why I own him. Or the person who owns him has given him to me. That's my legally sufficient thing. And so Lord Mansfield could have said, well, that's right, he's a thing, so I'm not going to issue the writ of habeas corpus. But instead, what he did, he assumed without deciding that the black slave could be a legal person, and then ended up deciding that he was a legal person. And the reason he did it, when the parties wouldn't settle, Lord Mansfield threw up his hands and said, well, then let justice be done, though the heavens may fall, in Latin. And that's why my third book I called Though the Heavens May Fall. That's the name of the book where I talked about that case. And Lord Mansfield said that slavery was so odious that the common law would not support it, and he was free to go. And so I had written that book as a blueprint for what I intended the Nonhuman Rights Project to do, when we could do it, when we were ready, and when the time around us was right, when we had a chance of winning. I wanted to bring suit when I thought we had the first reasonable chance of prevailing. So much of the research we did between 2007 and 2013 was scrutinizing how each of the 50 American states deals with all the myriad aspects of writs of habeas corpus, common law writs of habeas corpus. And New York seemed to us to be a really good state. So we then, on December 2nd, sought a writ of habeas corpus on behalf of Tommy, a chimpanzee, who was, pardon me, I have to retreat just a moment. You didn't tell me to get Reba. I probably couldn't see him. So Reba and Merlin, let me go back just for a second. So, because we brought the lawsuit about Tommy, on behalf of Tommy, what happened to Reba and Merlin? What happened to them is that they died before we could file the lawsuit. So I showed up in April of 2013 and learned that Reba had just died 3 weeks ago. And we're just in the final phases of our lawsuit in September. Last September, I send my executive director down there saying, check out Merlin, and Merlin's dead. Merlin died the night before. So we became very upset personally about it. And also very upset that we didn't have a client in Man either. So we thought we had a moral obligation to find every chimpanzee in the state of New York and file as many writs of habeas corpus virtually simultaneously as we could. So we were able to find 5 chimpanzees in the state of New York. And I went to visit them as much as I could. Tommy was in a cage in like a warehouse in a place that sold used trailers. So I was able to talk myself onto the property and actually see Tommy without lying, without doing anything wrong. No one asked me why I was interested. And so I was able to go on there. Of course, it was strange. The New York Times had commissioned someone to write an article in the Sunday New York Times magazine about our work, and it's coming out in the next month or two, we hope. It's a long one, too. And also, a man named D.A. Pennybaker and his wife and fellow filmmaker, Chris Hedges. D.A. Pennybaker is the first documentary filmmaker to win an Academy Award for Lifetime Achievement, which he won in 2012. They've been filming what we've been doing for the last 2.5 years. So not only did I go on the property, but the guy taking notes from the New York Times does, and the person goes on with a movie camera, too. So all of us go on there, and we film Tommy. And then we drove to Niagara Falls. That's not for me, is it? Okay. I thought that was someone saying, okay, I've heard enough, wrap it up. So we then drove, whatever, 300 miles, 250 miles to Niagara Falls, which is it's far away from where Tommy was, because I had believed that there were two chimpanzees being kept in a cement storefront in Niagara Falls. And we learned these from the internet. And so, again, I kind of yelled in, hello, Ellen, and the guy comes out, and I never actually see Kiko and Charlie, but at the end of about a half an hour conversation, it's clear that they're there, along with about 29 other monkeys that I can see. And again, the man from the New York Times is taking notes, and the other person's filming everything right beside us. We're still not clear what they thought was going on. We then found two other chimpanzees on Long Island, New York, that are being used for biomedical research on locomotion studies in Stony Brook University. They stonewalled us entirely, no matter who we went to, the researchers, the media relations department, the office of the president, nobody would confirm that the chimpanzees were there, that they had ever been there. So we had to then kind of use various other sources, and within a week or two, we were able to confirm with a 95% certainty that Leo and Hercules were there in somewhere on that campus that nobody would confirm. So we filed then three different lawsuits in three different jurisdictions of New York. By the time we could do that, Charlie was dead. So three of the seven chimpanzees in the state of New York that we had identified, they were dead before we could even file suit. So we now filed one suit in Niagara Falls on behalf of Kiko, one in central New York on behalf of Tommy, and two on Long Island, New York, eastern New York, on behalf of Hercules and Leo. And we expected to lose these lawsuits because everybody's not a Lord Mansfield. I understand that. We're looking for Lord Mansfields, but we understand that I said he was the greatest judge ever to speak English, so you don't run into the greatest judge ever to speak English every day. So we're hoping that the appellate courts of New York might view us in a very favorable way, but first we had to go into the lower courts, which, for the reason which I don't fully understand, in New York State are called the Supreme Courts. So the Supreme Court is the lowest court, and the Court of Appeals is the highest court, and then there's an intermediate court. So we wondered, though I think we had a pretty good idea, we wondered whether the judge would issue the writ of habeas corpus. We asked that they issue it. And you had to be a person in order to get a writ of habeas corpus in New York State, which was, we're really talking about the same problem that Lord Mansfield was faced with. And then when the James Somerset case came. And in all three courts, we filed suit on behalf of Tommy, and then in Niagara Falls on behalf of Charlie and Kiko, and Hercules and Leo, I'm sorry, Charlie was dead, half of Kiko, Hercules and Leo, then each time the judge said, I'm not going to issue the writ of habeas corpus because chimpanzee's not a person. So we understood that that was the most likely outcome, which meant we lost immediately. I mean, we both filed the suit before lunch and lost the suit before lunch. Because we went one after another, three different days in the week of December 2nd, 2013. As soon as the judges, when we'd walk in, we'd say, we want you to issue the writ of habeas corpus. And they'd say, we're not going to do it. That was the end of the case. So we were prepared for that. Although we filed, and you can go onto our website, nonhumanrights.org, and you can see what we filed. A writ of habeas corpus, a petition that was about 15 pages, a memorandum that was 80 pages, about 25,000 words, And also, we needed to prove what I had told you I had been talking about with respect to the elephants, the cetaceans, and the chimpanzees. We needed to show that our chimpanzees were autonomous. So we spent many months identifying the top chimpanzee, the top working chimpanzee experts in the world. And we spoke to them, with a few exceptions. They were very cooperative with us. They wanted to work with us. And we ended up filing about 100 pages of affidavits from 9 of these experts. One was in Sweden, one in Germany, one in Japan, one in Scotland, one in England, and 4 of them in the United States. And I won't even bore you with just the technical legal problems of New York law, of trying to get a Japanese affidavit into evidence in a New York courtroom. We had to end up hiring law firms in each of these countries, and they had to go through all kinds of procedural hoops. It was quite something. So each of the judges got a stack of papers that was, about that high. And none of them read it before we lost. We know that because they simply didn't have the time to do it. In fact, our first case on behalf of Tommy, the judge just said he got it like within an hour, and he wasn't even in the courthouse. He comes in the courthouse, and immediately we're told we're going to have a hearing. We had no idea what was going to happen. All of a sudden, we're there. For the first time in my life, I'm arguing as an animal rights lawyer. Truly, I'm arguing that a non-human animal is a person with a legal right to not be imprisoned and can win a petition for habeas corpus. And the transcripts of that argument, as well as the second argument we have, are also up on www.nonhumanrights.org. You can be there with us. You can see what the judge was saying, what we were saying. You can see where the judge can't get me to stop talking and tells me to sit down and shut up. And later, then he lets me stand up again and continue. So you can watch, and you can watch how they get hung up on the issue of person. And the judge in Niagara Falls really gets to what we thought was the crucial issue. Both of the judges who held hearings, one of the judges just gave us the papers back saying, you lose, he's not a person. But the other two actually held hearings. And the one in Niagara Falls and the one with respect to Tommy. And you can see that both of them say, your papers are extraordinary. They're excellent. And your arguments are really, really good. You lose. And the judge in Niagara Falls explained why in just one sentence. He said that I'm not going to be the first to make this leap of faith. And he used the word leap of faith. And I hope you understand the meaning of that, since there's probably not a lot of native English speakers here other than myself. So he said, I'm not going to make that leap of faith. Even if I agree with you, I'm not sure if you did, but I'm not going to be the first person to do this. I want to be told by a higher court that that's what I'm supposed to do. And the other judge in Tommy's case, you can see from the transcript, he was extraordinarily sympathetic to us. And he said, I'm going to keep this case, and if you can find any other reason except a writ of habeas corpus that I can use to get him out of there, I'll do it. And we said, well, if there was any other reason, we wouldn't be here in front of you on a writ of habeas corpus. So we lost, and the reason was that he wasn't a person. So we understood that he was extraordinarily helpful to us. We made it clear to him that we wanted to appeal his ruling, and he would actually go off of the record so you can't see it, and he would actually talk to us about how we can make sure that our case essentially is as strong as it could be to take it up on appeal. Very sympathetic person. He said he loved animals. Good. But loving animals and finding that they're legal persons with rights are not, one may be a predicate to the other. I mean, one may be a sufficient condition or a necessary condition, but it's not sufficient. You can love animals and still say you lose, which happened. So there are 4 intermediate appellate courts in New York State. And we happen each of them having different geographical regions from which they accept appeals. And so we found ourselves in 3 of them. So we have 3 simultaneous appeals that are going up, and they're all moving along. And then all 4 courts then feed into the Court of Appeals of New York. And our briefs, we have two, I think one brief in, the second one's going in tomorrow, the third one's going in next week when I get back from Switzerland. And then the other side, if we'll do whatever they're going to do, and we hope there's oral argument, and we hope to be able to then win, and if not, then we're going up to appeal to the Court of Appeals, anything that we do not win in New York. And we may not win there. We may just lose our first cases. We may lose our first 5 years of cases. We don't know. Nobody's ever tried it before. We've made our best arguments, and I'll just take a few minutes. This isn't a law school, so I didn't want to really be too technical about the kind of arguments that we are making. But we think they're super arguments. And they're also arguments that others have made. See, we're just lawyers. We're not all that smart. We just do what other people do. So what I did was spend years trying to understand where rights came from, why humans have rights. And then I wrote Though the Heavens May Fall, showing why this black man was entitled to rights, ultimately, and be seen as a legal person. And then we are essentially following that as a blueprint. And we're trying to understand what are the fundamental principles that the judges hold. We are not trying to make new law. We go in front of the judge and we say, we're just looking at the values and principles that you already claim that you follow. And we're telling you, if you're going to follow them, then our chimpanzee or our elephant or whatever has to then be a legal person with certain kinds of fundamental rights. And so as I spent those years researching it, I kept coming up with the principles of liberty and equality. They are all over the state constitutions of the United States, the U.S. Constitution, international treaties. I'm sure that the Swiss Constitution has the word liberty, equality, or both of them in it. If not, I'm sure there's a lot of statutes that say that. So we talked about, what liberty is. And liberty, from a legal point of view, is a kind of a non-comparative right. Equality is a kind of a comparative right. So liberty, someone has a liberty right because of who they are, or what their status is, or how they're put together, without comparing them to somebody else. Just what they have is sufficient. And that's my autonomy argument. I argue, here I've kind of talked about it in 10 minutes, but that's because it took me 20 years to figure it out. Now it seems like, I should have figured it out in 20 days, but alas, as I said, we lawyers aren't that smart. So what happened is that now we understand it quite well, and we're arguing that autonomy indeed is a sufficient condition for rights and the reason it is, Judge, is because look at the cases that are in your state that talk about autonomy. In fact, in Rattling the Cage, that's when I began to really develop the idea in 2000 about why it was that would be so. And one of the things I did was focus on what happens when a court is confronted with a human being who is not autonomous, never has been autonomous, and never will be autonomous. They happen, they're there all the time. If you have a child who's born without a brain, an anencephalic child, what do they say? Oh, let's just bring them straight down to the cafeteria and have them for dinner. That's not what they say, I guarantee you. They find that being, or we're going to do vivisection on them? No, that entity has legal rights, is a legal person. And watching how the judges grapple with that problem, they have a very, very difficult time. And they start engaging in the legal fiction that this anencephalic infant is autonomous. I showed state after state after state in which the high courts would have a non-autonomous plaintiff in front of them, and they couldn't say, we know that they don't have a brain, so then what? Why would they care? The human being herself doesn't care. She doesn't have a brain. But why do the judges care? And the judges would essentially use a legal fiction and pretend that they're autonomous, oftentimes by bringing in a guardian of some kind, who then has to make the decision as to what should be done with the anencephalic child, say, assuming that they're autonomous. If they were autonomous, then what would a non-autonomous being, a non-autonomous child do if she had autonomy but knew she was not autonomous? And that's what some of the courts have said. So watching them tie themselves into knots was what I found to be very interesting, because it showed, it was another piece of a demonstration, how much judges valued autonomy and how human dignity stem from our autonomy. Either it's actually there, or it's there because they're going to use a legal fiction and they're going to pretend it's there. And judges, I'm not sure if they do it in Switzerland, but in common law countries, judges sometimes engage in legal fictions, which is a lie that they tell you that you're required to believe. And my favorite one was in the 18th century, where a case would only turn out the way the judges wanted to if Paris was in England. And it was. Paris was in England, and the case turned out a certain way. So that's not a whole lot stranger than having a judge ask what a child who is born without a brain would want to do. Because obviously she never has, never is, and never will want to do anything. And that, and I have many other kinds of arguments all focused on the idea that judges value not human beings, because, you know, again, if you have a human being, and this is hard for people to deal with sometimes, they misunderstand what I'm saying sometimes. You know, an anencephalic child is essentially like a container. The question is, she's genetically a human being, but she doesn't have a brain. She doesn't have anything that human beings recognize as being human or as being valuable in what we are. And so judges are going to have to then so figure out what sort of characteristic do they either want to find that she has, or do they want to assume that she has in order to make everyone understand why she's entitled to legal rights and legal personhood. So our arguments are that courts don't say that human beings have rights, because there's no reason why just the shell of a human being should have rights. There must be something about us. And I just would say to the judge, well, you tell me, what is it about a human being? And I'll tell you, our chimpanzee has it too. Our chimpanzee, the only thing about our chimpanzee that's different from at least some human beings, or many human beings, is that they're chimpanzees. They're not humans. But look at, we have 100 pages of affidavits showing that chimpanzees are autonomous. In fact, I went through all the affidavits and I pulled out 60 different advanced cognitive abilities that the various experts had talked about, including something like engaging in mental time travel, which Matthias Oswald from Sweden does, showing that very clearly in a real series of terrific experiments that chimpanzees understand the past, plan for the future, and carry it out. And one really simple kind of a thing is there's a chimpanzee that Matthias Oswald looks at in a zoo in Sweden. And the chimpanzee apparently is not all that happy about being a chimpanzee in a zoo in Sweden. He doesn't like the fact that people come and gawk at him. So in the mornings, he's on an island, he goes around and he finds all these rocks and he hides them. And when people come to look at him, he starts throwing them at the people. So not only, so it's just morning, it's 6 a.m., you know, the fog is rising in the zoo, and he's sitting there gathering stones and hiding them so nobody can find them, and waiting till these damn human beings come in and look at me, and then 6 hours later, 8 hours later, he's getting the rocks and he's pelting them with it. So this chimpanzee understands that there is a future and can plan for it. That's just one of a series of experiments that he's done, really great experiments, but others too, showing that these are extraordinary beings. And of course, a being that can anticipate the future and understand the past is also the kind that is going to suffer a lot by being held in captivity. They can imagine the future and it looks terrible. It's terrible. So we talk about that as well. So our arguments focus on autonomy, arguing that it is that under the law, as the judge herself understands it, our chimpanzee plaintiff is entitled to a writ of habeas corpus. She's autonomous. and she can self-determine, and that is held to be an exceedingly important attribute worth protecting. Now, we have an equality argument. An equality argument means that equality is a comparative right. That means you're entitled to it, not in an absolute way, the way you are, say, with having autonomy as a non-comparative liberty right. You're entitled to a right or personhood because you're like someone else who has personhood and rights in a relevant way. And of course, the key word there is in a relevant way. So you compare yourself to someone else, and if that person has the right you want, you say, when I say person, I don't mean human being. I mean a legal person, although almost they all are, right? Not just temporarily. And you look at that and you say, hey, they have this legal right to bodily liberty or bodily integrity. What is it about them that gives them that right? And I'd say, well, whatever it is, our chimpanzee has it as well. And of course, you could say, well, the difference is, dummy, is that they're a human being and your chimpanzee's not. I'd say that is a distinction without a difference. A distinction without a difference. So what? You've picked out a trait, but tell me what the relevance is of just the fact that this being is a genetic human being and this being is a genetic chimpanzee. Whatever is filled in that cup that makes that human being be valuable, our chimpanzee has it too. And we talk about, there's various kinds of equality arguments you can make, but the courts, we show in the state of New York, certainly in other places as well, there's a certain kind of an equality argument that kind of mixes in a liberty argument as well. So a court not only looks to see whether there are relevant similarities or differences, but also says there are certain ones that are simply ones that we're not going to use. They're simply out of bounds. That the discrimination based upon that issue would be invidious. It should be illegal. So there are cases, our U.S. Supreme Court has said that discriminating against someone just because they're gay is a kind of invidious sort of discrimination, at least under certain circumstances. It's been held in discriminate against them because of their religion or their race. So there are certain kinds of invidious discriminations, and we'd say just because our client is a chimpanzee, and you're saying we can do anything you want, we're going to make him a thing that we can then carve him up, eat him, put him in a cage, do whatever you want with him, just because he's a chimpanzee, even though he's a lot smarter and a lot more autonomous than millions and millions of human beings, so you can't do that to, that is a distinction without a difference. That's like saying, oh, I can imprison you, but you can't imprison me. Why? Because you have brown eyes and I have blue eyes. Well, that's a difference. I'd say, yeah, but it's a distinction without a difference. It's not a relevant difference. And our argument to the court is that standing alone, the species itself, is not a relevant difference any more than gender might be or religion might be or anything you're born with, certainly, whether you're gay or whether you're not gay. That these things are, these that discrimination based on those kinds of characteristics are invidious and should be out of bounds. You need to look at the qualities involved. So, briefly, I think it was more than 30 seconds or 2 minutes, but briefly, that's, and you can see all 80 glorious pages, if you want, on our website. You can see where we go through these arguments, citing New York cases at every point, or sometimes a U.S. Supreme Court case, and that's the kind of argument we are making. And by the way, the Somerset case, which was the one that Lord Mansfield decided in 1772, one of the reasons I loved it so much is that on July 4th, 1776, the American colonies broke away from England. And almost every state adopted the common law of England as of the 4th of July of 1776. So the common law of England includes the Somerset decision, which is now the common law of virtually every single American state. So I say, well, under the common law, by the way, which we've adopted, which includes the Somerset case, and then I start talking about what happened in the Somerset case, that the writ of habeas corpus, which was broad enough to bring in James Somerset at a time when blacks were not seen as legal persons, it's also broad enough to bring in Tommy or Hercules or Leo or Kiko. So, as you might imagine, I can go on. It's, you know, every aspect of this, obviously, if we spend 30,000 hours preparing, it's kind of like a fractal. You know, you go at it, and you look at it closer up, and then it's just as complicated as it was before, and you look at it closer up, and it's still just as complicated as it was before. But we think that our arguments are not different in kind, maybe in some kind of degree, but not in kind, from the principles or the arguments that lawyers and judges in the common law countries, certainly in the United States, use and day in and day out, and were educated with law schools. And the only thing that is standing between the personhood and fundamental rights of our, right now, our chimpanzee clients, is some kind of either overt or implied discrimination against them simply because they're chimpanzees. Or simply because they're not humans. And we go right to it from the very first sentence of our brief. This is wrong. This is why it's wrong. In fact, the first section we have is that legal person is not synonymous with human beings. And we briefly show that at one time there were human beings who were not persons. Black slaves are certainly one, you know, great example. But on the other side, common law courts, we cite a pre-independence Indian case where a Hindu idol was set to be a person, a 2000 Indian Supreme Court case where the holy books of the Sikh religion is a person, a Pakistani case where a mosque is a person, and a 2012 treaty between the indigenous peoples of New Zealand and the Crown that says a certain river is a person. So what we're saying is that personhood means that the legal system believes that the person ought to be protected, ought to have one or more legal rights. It has nothing to do with being human, because there have been a lot of humans who weren't persons, and there are non-humans who are persons. And I'm even passing over the fact that there are probably, you know, 25 million corporations in the United States that are legal persons. In fact, our U.S. Supreme Court just heard an argument last Monday as to whether or not a corporation had a right to exercise religion. And I think they're going to find that they did. What can I say? Except I think that's going to be wrong and a mistake. But there you go. You have the U.S. Supreme Court even hearing the argument that a corporation has a right to free exercise of religion. So I'll end with, and then I hope you ask me questions or can stimulate a discussion, because if you don't, I will think I was either completely clear or totally opaque. So, my own feeling is I probably was not either. So right now, the Nonhuman Rights Project we're bringing our first three cases up to appeal. If we win, hallelujah, we move on. If we lose, we say, why did we lose? Did we have the wrong plaintiff, the wrong argument, the wrong state, the wrong cause of action? And we're ready for that. We just want to see, we have to begin to see, if we lose, why we lose, and begin trying to fix that, and just begin bringing these cases. And as much money as we can possibly bring in, then we use that to bring more and more cases. We've already begun looking at our next case. It's not going to be in New York. It's probably going to be on behalf of a number of elephants. And so we're already scurrying around talking to elephant experts, you know, all over the world who are now signing on. Thank goodness they're signing on to help us. So we're going to probably have 100 pages of elephant expert affidavits too. Maybe not. Maybe as much is not known about elephant cognition as about chimpanzee, but a lot is. So that is the Nonhuman Rights Project. That's what we are doing. I've only really skimmed the surface. If you want to look deeper into what we're doing, good or bad, everything that happens, we put up on our website. You know, if you're having trouble getting to sleep, you can read our briefs, and I think some of you might find it interesting. So if there are any questions or comments, I would be delighted to take them.
proposition. Okay, yes.
Yes, hi. I'm truly had many questions about where the line should be drawn. And quite a few things came to my mind while you were talking. And I was thinking of an embryo. Is this a recipient?
Well, if you look at our two arguments right now, is that autonomy is a sufficient condition for a liberty right to bodily integrity. So not only would an embryo not be involved, but any human being who is not autonomous would also not be entitled to legal personhood under that argument. We're not saying that autonomy is a necessary condition, we're simply saying it's a sufficient condition, that if an autonomous being presents himself to a court, or so we can present an autonomous being to a court, that her autonomy is a sufficient condition for legal personhood. Now, as far as equality goes, equality is a very subjective issue. And I can't even begin to predict how that would work. The United States has been in pitched battles over abortion and fetuses since Roe v. Wade in 1972. So we don't wade into that unless we absolutely have to, because we don't think it has anything to do with what we're doing. But when I'm on a radio show or a television show sometimes, someone, the hostess, might turn to me and say, well, what about fetuses? And I say, I really can't hear very well. Okay. Yes?
Strategically, is it win the case?
Yes.
And would you hope for more cases? So I just don't understand the whole.
You don't understand our entire.
I study law, but I don't study common law, so I don't have an idea. But if you would win the case,
yes,
you would want to sue more rights, so you could gain every single different right for the animals, or would you want it on a political level to continue? So you have a set.
Well, the common law kind of is a political level. It's not easy to understand how it all works.
Yeah, because I'm used to
it. I understand. So, the common law is really unwritten law.
Yeah.
And just like, I was talking to a British lawyer the other day, and he's talking about his constitution. But I know, we have a written constitution, and England has a common law, an unwritten common law, and an unwritten constitution. And I never understand what's in it. And just like if someone asks me what the common law is, it's really a beautiful thing, the common law, in that it is made to not be static and to expand and move around as experience, scientific fact, as the world changes, the judges will then step in and say, well, we have to change this. Or, more likely, the really, really good judges will say, we're not changing it. It's always been that way. And we'll explain to you why it's always been that way. And so, and some other judges say, what do you mean? It's never been that way. They'll say, oh, yes, all we're doing is we're just changing it just kind of a little because the facts are not the same. It's very complex, but it is definitely something that is made to be expanded as the world around it changes, as ethics changes. So what we would do, whether we win or lose, we'll essentially do similar things. We would, if we win, we may then bring the same case in other states, a writ of habeas corpus, or we might then seek a different kind of an appropriate right for the chimpanzee that we want for. Okay, now they have this right, now shouldn't they have this right? Or we might then sue on behalf of a different species in the same jurisdiction, or chimpanzee in a different jurisdiction. Good part of litigating, the good and bad part of litigating in common law in the United States is that there's 50 jurisdictions. And so there's a lot of different courts you can go to. That's correct. Believe it or not, each of the 50 states is a Supreme Court in and of itself that is not bound by anybody else. Mm-hmm. And so,
well,
there's a lot to learn.
You have to, for each which right you're fighting, you have to win in each
state. In each state. But we also understand that that legislatures are going to jump in once they see that this is a serious thing. There's going to be a lot of legislative activity that's going to go way past anything we can control. The metaphor that I use in Rattling the Cage, and I've used in other books as well, is that there's this gray wall that exists and has long existed with humans, but all humans now, but only humans on one side of it, and the rest of the animals on the other side. And we humans are all persons, and all the other animals are non-persons. And what we're trying to do is really break through that wall and win one right for one non-human animal. Because we think that the question that judges would grapple with would change from, oh, are you a human? Because if you're not a human, you lose. That was quick. And the 10 minutes it took for us to lose. So, but we would like the courts to say, well, agree with us that species is an irrelevant characteristic, that it's who they are, what kind of qualities are you talking about that ought to be protected? And is this the kind of being who has these, whatever they're going to be, whatever these kinds of qualities that ought to be protected? Which the way, maybe to a civil lawyer, this sounds like your worst nightmare. Yeah, but to us, it's just, that's how the game's been played for centuries. And so you just keep pushing a different set of facts in a different state, a different cause of action, a different right you're asking for, a different plaintiff, a different species, and try to, and then judges then have to grapple with does the change that you're proposing cause them to change their mind, or does it not cause them to change their mind? After spending 30,000 hours, we thought that we were ready to find out, we are intending to have these first cases be the first shots of a long-term strategic litigation campaign. So whether we win or whether we lose, we're moving ahead, raising money, bringing in lawyers. We're going to be just pushing, as you can do in the common law. Sometimes I cited a sentence that Winston Churchill said after the British, who had been were being beaten by the Germans a long time, until 1942 in the Battle of El Alamein. And he gave a speech in London, and even though it was a resounding victory for the British, he said that this is not the end. He says, it's not even the beginning of the end. He says, but it is perhaps the end of the beginning. And that's what we see our litigation. This is the end of the beginning. Yeah.
Thanks so much for the very interesting talk.
Oh, you're very welcome. Thank you for inviting me.
I have a quick question. You said that at the moment you have these three appeals going on.
Yes.
Could you just quickly sketch what courts would be next to come? But could you maybe elaborate on this? When do you expect the decisions from the appellate court?
Yes.
And how does it continue? Could you even go to the Supreme Court?
No.
Or not look at common law?
Yes. I didn't mention the fact that each of the 50 states is its own sovereign in the matter of its own state law, but overlaying the whole thing is federal law. And in our Constitution, the tension, I'm sure you have it here in Switzerland too, the tension between what issues are solely for the states, what issues are solely for the federal government, and which ones can be either, it's always, decade after decade, century after century, you move in one direction or the other direction. But it's clear that the federal courts generally are not common law courts, that the job of a federal court in the United States is to interpret a statute, the Constitution, or a treaty. Generally, that's what they're supposed to do. Sometimes if two people from different states sue, that they might end up interpreting state law, but generally they have to look at what did the Congress mean when it passed this statute? What does the Constitution mean? What does this international treaty mean? That's what they do. They don't do, essentially they don't do common law. And why would we be so infatuated with common law? I'm glad you asked that question. The reason is because
We don't want to go in front of a court where they're looking at a statute and they have to look at the intention of the legislature. Did the legislature intend, when they used the word person in the statute, to include chimpanzees? The answer is always no. Always. So why bother? We're simply wasting our time. We don't want to be in the federal system. So, when we're in the state system, we don't wish to be in having the state courts to be interpreting the state constitution or the state statutes or the federal constitution or federal statutes. We want them to be using the common law. We don't want the courts to be interpreting what somebody else said and they're trying to figure out, did they mean in chimpanzees when they said the word person? We're saying, you're a common law court. You're as powerful as a legislature under our common law system. And if the legislature has not spoken, then you have a duty as a judge, as a common law judge, to do what is right. Just like Lord Mansfield said, slavery is so odious that the common law will not support it. And we're saying imprisoning these chimpanzees is so odious that the common law should not support it. So that answered part of your question, I hope.
Right. Okay.
Let me get to the other. This is specifically about our cases. So, another beautiful thing. There are, and it's not as beautiful. It's not very beautiful. There are 50 states. Each of them has their own bar. I'm a member of the Massachusetts bar. I cannot practice law in the other 49 states. And the only way I can, I'm not licensed to do that. The only way I can is I can bring on a New York lawyer, say, or a Kansas lawyer, or a California lawyer, and ask, and that lawyer will then move to have the court, as a matter of its discretion, admit me to practice law for the purpose of that case. So I'm not a member of the New York bar. I am now, for the purposes of these cases. So at least two out of the three appellate courts have said, yes, you're a member of the bar, you can. And the other one hasn't said no, it just hasn't said anything yet. So the reason I said that is that I've never been in the New York courts before. So I'm not really sure how long things take in the New York appellate courts, at least from personal experience. If it was Massachusetts, I could tell you. What we know is that all the briefs will probably be in by June 1st. And then we're in the intermediate appellate courts. There's the trial courts below where we are and the Court of Appeals above. So these courts have the discretion to allow us to argue the case orally. We've asked that we be allowed to argue the case orally in all three courts. We hope that that will happen. And if that happens, then we think that that will occur sometime, you know, in the probably the late fall of 2014. I don't really know how long it would take to have a decision come down. My guess is at least several months. So it'll probably be another year before we know whether we've won or lost in each of the three intermediate appellate courts. Then the Court of Appeals of New York has discretion whether they're going to hear our further appeal. And no one's ever done it before. So the problem is that, you know, there's like an N of zero. We can't look at anything. We just have to make our best guesses. That's a problem that we've had to deal with from day one. For example, we have arguments within the Nonhuman Rights Project as to what kind of a case this is, because what kind of a case would we like it to be with respect to how a judge might view it. A judge who views it as a civil liberties case, for example, might view it in a different way than a judge who views it as a property case. So if a judge in her heart believes this is a property case, then we're probably going to lose. If the judge in her heart believes this is a civil rights case, then we think we may be able to win, because there are two different narratives going on here. We're saying this is a person and who's being deprived of his civil rights. And the other people are saying this is a piece of property. The whole thing, the idea that it would have a civil right is ridiculous. My chair doesn't. My dog doesn't. Why should this chimpanzee have a civil right? And so there's two strongly differentiated competing narratives. And which ones a judge, you know, buys into, and I don't mean that in a bad way, I mean what their heart and brain tells them, I think could end up being conclusive as to how seriously they take our arguments. But meanwhile, we're pursuing those cases, but then we're also beginning a new case involving, likely involving elephants in another state. And then meanwhile, you know, we have four or five other states that are kind of lined up, and we're looking at other animals. We're looking at orcas, we're looking at chimpanzees in other states. We've decided not to file suit on certain with respect to chimpanzees in other states because we think that the law is not very favorable to us. We kind of went the opposite of how lawyers usually do. Usually, if I'm sitting in my law office, I have a client who comes in, tells me a problem, and I pretty much know where I'm going to file suit. We're doing the opposite. We're trying to figure out which of the 50 states we want to file suit in, and then we want to find a client. And it turns out we wanted to file suit on behalf of an orca in New York. There just weren't any. And there are orcas in Florida, and we think the law in Florida is not advantageous to us. So we're always having to weigh, you know, great dozens of factors when trying to decide which animal in which court and then which cause of action. Yeah.
How likely is it that you just become a judge yourself in a Supreme Court and just pass the law? I mean that would be
it is impossible.
It's impossible.
Yes.
So how do people become a lawyer?
I'm
not a lawyer.
Not the way they do here, almost certainly. So in the United States, you have to go to college for 4 years. And I have a bachelor's degree in chemistry, and so which has helped me enormously in my litigation. You know, many people who don't have science degrees are afraid of science. And I'm not. And so I actually spend a lot of time with scientists, you know, around the world talking to them about their work. I subscribe to Nature. I read Nature every week. I read Science every week. I read Scientific American. Science is something I was always interested in. But I have a degree in chemistry, and other people have degrees oftentimes in English or political science or something like that, or philosophy. And by the way, I love people with degrees in philosophy to take my classes because they think, they are not fuzzy thinkers, they are very sharp thinkers. Just like, if I may say, those of us who have science degrees, we're also, you know, sharp thinkers. You can't, it's not your opinion. You know, well, how good was the story? What was the author thinking? That's not what we're doing. The question is, did you get the answer right or not? And so, you know, we can't just say, oh, everybody has their own opinion. You know, they don't. So those of us in especially in the hard sciences, but also in philosophy, I think they are very rigorous thinkers, which has been really, really good. So whatever degree you get, you then apply to a law school. That's 3 more years. And then the law schools, they then either take you or they don't. And you then come out. Everyone studies very similar things, no matter what law school you're in. You study similar things. The quality of your professors, the quality of your fellow students may be very different. But the subjects you study are similar. And then we all get out of law school, and we're supposed to be able to practice any kind of law we want. The amount of ineptitude in the American bar, you know, you can imagine, especially in early years, is great. And you can do like me. I had no apprenticeship. I was a law partner with someone else who just graduated. So we couldn't. The first jury trial I ever did was the first jury trial I ever saw. And I just stood to address the jury because the district attorney had gone before me, and I just stood where he stood. Other than that, I had no clue. And plus, unbelievably, in that first case, I actually had a jury find my client not guilty on grounds of insanity. So it wasn't the easiest case either. But on the other hand, after we won, then the judge said, well, now we'll decide whether we're going to confine him in a mental institution. I said, jeez, I didn't think of that. But it turned out that just by sheer chance, I had managed to put enough evidence to show that he no longer was insane, but he was insane at the time he committed the crime. So they let him walk out of the court too. Not because I was partly brilliant and partly I was a complete moron as to what I was doing. So anybody can practice law. And then our bar,
our judges, there's no schools for judges. They come from the lawyers. You have to, nice to know the governor if you want to be a state judge, or if you know the president of the United States, or your state, your senator in Congress. But we're all kind of equally qualified. Why would I not want to be a judge and then pass my own law? Well, that can't happen. Well, first of all, I don't want to be a judge.
No, I mean, not your lawyers, right? You have someone from the inner circle, and you 20 guys try to become a judge, and you want to be a judge.
There's all kinds of checks and balances on this. I mean, first of all, in the highest court of any state, there's usually either 5 or 7 judges. So one person might write a dissent, but he or she is not going to carry the day. Or maybe they'll carry one other judge. It has to be a change in the law. People have to agree. And ultimately, the legislature in the United States can trump on a common law issue the judges. So it's quite possible that we could have, say, the New York Court of Appeals say, or another court say, yes, a writ of habeas corpus applies to a chimpanzee. And the legislature the next day in New York says, we pass a statute. No, it doesn't. Of course, there's something, there's a little kicker on that, in that the New York Constitution has what's called a suspension clause. It says that the legislature is not allowed to cut back on the writ of habeas corpus. So it's a heck of a complex kind of pulsing mass as to how it all turns out. But it's not as easy as, me and my friends are going to be judges and that's the end of it. That's not happening. Yes?
I was wondering, maybe an argument which you hear quite often is that some people think that humans are able of believing in some faith, God, something, if they claim that animals can't. So,
I have heard that. You can argue it from a philosophical point of view. From a legal point of view, in the United States, we have a separation between church and state. I think I was talking to Adriano today about that, or someone about the separation between church and state. Because I went into a court in Quebec once, and there was a huge cross with Jesus nailed to it in the courtroom. Well, for me, I'm saying, holy smoke. I mean, there is no religious stuff brought. I mean, for one thing, in the United States, there's probably, 150 religions. There's probably 500 religions or 5,000 religions. There's no state religion. In fact, almost certainly, we have more Protestants in the United States than anyone else. There's a million kinds of Protestants. But on our Supreme Court, we have 3 Jews and 6 Catholics. There are no Protestants who sit on the United States Supreme Court. So we have a what's supposed to be a strict separation between church and state. So if somebody stood up and made that argument, I would argue to the judge, first of all, it's not a legal argument because it's not capable of being either proven or disproven. It's not a scientific argument, that's for sure. And then I'd say, as a matter of our Constitution, it's just an argument that's out of bounds. And I can point to a case, for example, up until the 1960s, in many states, miscegenation, or the marriage between people of 2 different races, was a crime in the United States. And the aptly named case of Loving versus Virginia was decided, I think, in 1963 and 1964, and it held that to be unconstitutional. And that stopped it everywhere within the United States. But it quoted the lower court Virginia judge, and the judge had said, well, look, God put black people in Africa and yellow people in China and white people in Europe. And if he meant them to mix, then he would have mixed them all up. Instead, and so the court said, that's not a legal argument. But yet that was the center of the miscegenation argument, by the court. And that, so I would say the same thing. In fact, I'd probably bring up the Loving versus Virginia case. Generally, except in kind of indirect ways. You may say, do unto others as you might have them do unto you, or something like that, where a court might say that. But to decide a lawsuit overtly on a religious ground, I think would be out of bounds. That doesn't mean judges don't decide on religious grounds and they give another ground for it. That certainly is possible. In fact, yes?
Yeah,
It is certainly possible, and that might indeed occur. And we actually address that in our briefs. We say we cite Richard Posner, who's probably the most respected scholar judge in the United States. He's a federal court of appeals judge out of Chicago, and he was in a debate with Peter Singer. And what he said was, and he and I have debated on television, and I really admire him. I also envy him and loathe him because he writes a book a year, a really good book a year, and he's a full-time judge, and he's an adjunct law professor, and he's just, you know, not human. So he's a really, really, really good judge. I mean, even though when I don't agree with him, I really respect him. And he said that the reason why I'm wrong, or the reason why non-human animals should never have rights, is he doesn't know, but he feels it really deeply, and he thinks that he is immune to any kind of an argument. That's how it is, which is a really interesting argument for a judge to make. But I think he's a very honest judge. I find him to be intellectually honest. I think that's what he's saying. He's saying if this case, a case like this, came in front of him, he would rule against this. And he wouldn't, not really clear why, but everything, every fiber in his being is saying, they're not humans, therefore they can't be persons, they can't be rights. I can't tell you why, don't bother arguing to me, I can't be convinced otherwise. And we think that it's just not him. We think that many people and many judges, I tell my students, judges are people. Judges live in the society, and so they're a reflection of our society. And in fact, one of the reasons that in 2013 was the first time we filed our suit was because in 1993, our country was not ready. 2003, 2008, 2013 was the time, I think, when we judged that we had some kind of that the world had changed, had evolved, so that we had some kind of a reasonable chance of winning or losing in a respectable way. And we got hundreds of newspapers and magazines and blogs, you know, reported our cases, and almost every single one either did it just as a straight news story, or they were actually on our side. There were a handful of them who said that we were just out of our minds. And one of them filed a complaint against me because I teach in a Catholic law school. The fact that why this Catholic school hiring this raving lunatic, you know, to teach animal rights jurisprudence at the law school. But that was really, really unusual.
Do we have further questions?
Yeah, I've been up like 33 hours. I can be up 34. Doesn't matter to me.
Can you imagine that non-humans, the responsibility is...
Say it again?
Okay,
the argument that in order to be a legal person, in order to have a right, you have to have a responsibility. So, to me, that seems like a fairly easy argument in that, look at my anencephalic child. What kind of responsibilities does she have? She can't have any responsibilities. You can't eat her, you can't do biomedical research on her. She has all kinds of rights, but she has no responsibilities. Our children are insane, are comatose. There's humans who are seriously incompetent, they have many rights and no responsibilities. I talk about a case in the United States where you had a six-year-old boy bring a gun to school and shoot and kill his six-year-old girl classmate in first grade. And I point out, he wasn't charged with a crime. He wasn't sued civilly. He's not held to be responsible. But yet, you couldn't vivisect him. You know, you couldn't eat him. I mean, he has a lot of rights, but he doesn't have any responsibilities. And should he have like a brain damage right there, and he's never more than six than the day he was then, he still would have all kinds of rights, but he had no responsibilities. So it seems to me that arguing that you have to have rights, you have to have responsibilities, you can't have rights, seems to be palpably and obviously false.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I do have to say, Adriano had to sit in my class for
28 hours in Lewis and Clark. So he's and he lived to tell the tale.
So thanks again for this fascinating presentation. This is usually the point where we have some sort of small present, you know, the usual bottle of wine.
Is that true?
But unfortunately, we don't have any for you. bad news, but there's also some good news. I have to say, we've noticed that you're also quite involved with the international EAA community, that is Effective Animal Activism, and which originated with the General Effective Altruist community. And yeah, as you told us in your talk, you're also very concerned about strategy and effectiveness, and I know that you don't like wasting money, and this is why we decided to instead go for a $100 donation to the Nonhuman Rights Project instead of...
Wonderful, thank you.
Present.
Thank you very much, that's wonderful.
There's one other thing I wanted to mention. The primary occasion of Steve's stay in Switzerland is the Animal Rights Conference held at Basel University's Law Faculty this Friday and Saturday. So there's a whole doctoral program at Basel University or its Law Faculty about law and animals. So this is really animal law being developed here in continental Europe. And as I said, this Friday and Saturday, a really extraordinary conference is taking place. There's a really awesome lineup of speakers. I can really recommend it. And I guess Steve's talk will be on Saturday, but there are about 20 very interesting speakers. The website of the conference, it's called The Animal Turn and the Law. The website says the conference is fully booked by now, but you can still try to register. I mean, you may be lucky and get on a waiting list, and if someone cancels their registration, you may still be able to get in if you're lucky. So, let's then move to the snacks, as announced, and thanks again, Steven, for having you with us.
Thank you.
Let's give him a round of applause.